Thank you. Could I please ask those members who are leaving the chamber to do so quickly and quietly, as we will now move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 14496 in the name of Tess White on importance of safe and fair sport for women and girls. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. And I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Tess White to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to lead this afternoon's debate during Scottish Women and Girls in Sport Week 2024. And I thank all those MSPs who've supported my motion, which addresses the importance of safe and fair sport for women and girls. Above all, from grassroots to elite level, it calls for single-sex categories for women in sport to be protected. Presiding Officer, let me say at the outset that I've worked in HR for over 30 years. Inclusion is in my professional DNA. As a second-dan karate black belt, so too are safety and fairness. From park run to Paralympics, we are seeing the erosion of fair and safe sport for women. In her recently published report on violence against women and girls in sports, Reem Al-Saleem, a UN special rapporteur, cites evidence that the average punching power of men is 162% greater than women. She references one study which asserts that even in non-elite sport, the least powerful man produced more power than the most powerful woman. How can anyone justify putting women and girls in harm's way? Male advantage exists in sports. And the facts? Males have around 40% more muscle mass. Men have larger hearts, lungs, and hemoglobin pools, which can feed them more oxygen. Men have longer legs and narrower pelvises, leading to better running gaits. And that is why biological sex matters in sport. It has always mattered in safe and fair sporting competitions, just as weight, age and disability matter. It's about safety, fairness and creating equality of opportunity. Society has become so captured by so-called inclusion that instead of levelling the playing field for women in sport, women are being marginalised even more than before. Reem Al-Saleem's report that found that over 600 female athletes in more than 400 competitions have lost more than 890 medals in 29 different sports when competing against biological males. So-called inclusion is leading to the exclusion of women from sport. It's the height of hypocrisy when we're working so hard to close the gender gap in sport and encourage the participation of women and girls. Thankfully, some sports governing bodies, such as World Athletics, FINA, and World Rugby, have pressed pause on trans inclusion. And this week, the World Darts Federation agreed that the women's competition is for biological women only. I particularly commend World Athletics President Sebastian Coe for doubling down on this policy earlier this year, saying it is absolutely vital that we protect, we defend, we preserve the female category, and I couldn't agree more. For every male in the female category, a female is excluded. Other international and national governing bodies must follow suit, and we need greater clarity on policies around differences in sexual development. Presiding Officer, I accept this is a sensitive and a complex topic, but it should not be a taboo topic, with women being bullied and silenced for speaking the truth. I am deeply concerned that women in sport are having to hold their heads above the parapet to challenge so-called inclusion policies. One female athlete even told the BBC Elite British Sportswomen Study 2024 that your career is over if you speak on it. We must be able to question the implication of trans inclusion in sport for women without condemnation and without recrimination. We must be able to call for the preservation of women's sports and challenge institutional cowardice, because that's what it is, institutional cowardice. The UK Equality Act 2010 is on our side, and I pay tribute to sportswomen such as Mara Yamuchi, Martina Navratilova and Sharon Davis for refusing to be silenced. Charities and campaign groups such as Sex Matters, Fair Play for Women, For Women Scotland and the Women's Rights Network should also be applauded for their work on this issue, and some of their members are in the gallery today. I asked former Olympian and international swimmer Sharon Davis to contribute some words to this afternoon's debate, and drawing on her own experience of competing against testosterone-enhanced athletes in the 1980 Olympics, she said, "Speaking up has cost me dearly. Over the last few years, with the inclusion of males in sports categories specifically created to give females equal opportunities, thousands of males have stolen female places. Not one single peer review study can show us we can remove all male advantage. No woman should have to die to prove the obvious. In a combat sport, this is a huge accident waiting to happen. In any contact sport, it is gross negligence. Men would not tolerate this inclusion if it affected their sports, but women are just expected to give up what is theirs by right. A female protected category and an open, fully inclusive category is the only answer." And she said, "Please do not throw the dreams of young girls away. They are no less worthy than our sportsmen. Thank you, Sharon." Presiding Officer, in closing, we must not stand by and take away the hope from young girls having female role models. They have to see it to be it. We must stand up for women and girls. We must protect women's sports. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. White. Could I remind all members who are seeking to speak in the debate to check whether or not they have pressed the request to speak button. And I call on Michelle Thompson to be followed by Sue Webber. Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate, and I am pleased to have signed this well-worded motion. I want to concentrate briefly on three themes, with my first theme being the safety of women and girls. Now, already quoted the United Nations Special Rapporteur, but I would add to the earlier comments from Tess White that female athletes are also more vulnerable to sustaining serious physical injuries when female-only sports spaces are open to men. Now, we know that male puberty develops significant physical advantage. Put simply, male bodies are bigger, faster and stronger than female bodies. This advantage is not removed if testosterone is lessened over a short time frame, such as 12 months. The physical differences between men and women are easiest to demonstrate by comparing performance levels in athletics. In this chamber, we have two former 400-metre runners, most notably in former Olympian athlete Brian Whittle, but also Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray. In their event, we find that at both elite and club-level men, on average, run 400 metres approximately 5 seconds faster than women. A very considerable difference, although I suspect both Brian Whittle and Neil Gray would beat me by a lot more than 5 seconds. Thankfully, World Athletics is now studying this issue, but multiple other bodies will also need to recognise this performance difference is true for all sports where physical attributes are significant. My second theme is around fairness, and it's ironic that male sport has long recognised that fair competition can only work if there is differentiation between age, weight, and other factors. Now, I have no experience of sport at an elite level, but I do have considerable experience of giving up many hours to hone my skills in music. And I can only begin to fathom the anger, disappointment and distress many female athletes feel about being asked to compete against men who identify as women. Fair competition is a fundamental in sport. It allows the best to be their best. And if the basis is changed where women cannot be their best, there will be no women's sport. Now, despite the motion being well written, there's one part of it with which I disagree. This is where it refers to inclusion policies. I don't think it's correct to characterise what has been happening as an inclusion policy. It's at least as much an exclusion policy, denying many female athletes in a wide range of sports the opportunity to compete. My final theme is a wider cultural problem already alluded to, created in recent years by the policy capture of the debate around sex and gender. It's got to the stage where even some elected politicians feel they cannot openly debate the issues. Cultural oppression needs challenging, and I'm therefore delighted that the motion recognises this. Coming to a close, Presiding Officer, the fundamental issue here is that sex is a far more meaningful and scientifically exact determinant of who should be allowed to take part in women's sport than gender. The consequences, if the situation is not challenged, is that participation in sports will become even less attractive to women, and that will undermine much of the good work of recent years. When biological men are given access to female-only changing rooms and take part in women's team sports, they violate the rights of women, remove fairness, and pose an increased risk of harm. Isn't it about time we wholeheartedly and unequivocally support the rights of women? Surely that is what a truly progressive parliament should do.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I now call Sue Webber to be followed by Rona Mackay. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank my colleague Tess White for bringing forward such an important debate this afternoon. And I want to wholeheartedly associate myself with the statements made in their speeches and contributions from Michelle Thompson and Tess White. Because I can't remember a point in my life when sport wasn't a major factor when I was growing up. In primary school, I played badminton competitions for Juniper Green, represented Edinburgh in school competitions, and travelled to Wales to play for the Lothians. At university, I had to choose between playing hockey or badminton. I chose hockey, and I threw myself into playing in the 1990s. That's giving my age away. Playing at Edinburgh University, there were only three women's teams at that time, and it was great fun, and you could always find me and my pals at Peffermill playing or umpiring. And I've made friends and memories for life. After I graduated from university sport, and hockey especially, continued to play a real pivotal role in my life, I balanced a busy corporate career with all of my sports, including Watsonians hockey, where I was a club president. I was the under 16 and under 18 team manager. I became the East District youth team manager and then East District president. I also umpired all through this, including umpiring men's and women's hockey at the top of the Scottish game. And there were not that many women umpiring men's hockey. Now, as injury and age have caught up with me, and when time permits, I assess new budding umpires. And all of this gave me life experiences and friendships that span decades and continents. I would not change a thing about my experience, and I hope that other girls and women can have the same positive experiences I did. And that's why I wanted to speak in this debate today, to highlight the unfairness that many now face in female sports. And we've all either seen or heard about some of the controversies surrounding this during the Olympics and then again in the Paralympics. And nowhere was this more apparent than the women's boxing in Paris and the controversy over the gender eligibility of two competitors. Algeria's Amin Khalif and Taiwan's Lin Yongting were cleared to compete at the Paris Olympics despite being disqualified from last year's World Championships after they were said to have failed gender eligibility tests. Both fighters won Olympic gold medals. And I think we can all agree that this has shone a damning light on an issue that clearly needs addressing. And as Tess White has explained in far more detail than me, males of equal weight and size punch 160% harder on a less dense bone structure. Therefore, biological sex is a crucial factor in ensuring that female athletes are not disadvantaged or put at risk. In 2023, British Cycling banned transgender women from competing in the female category of competitive events, tightening its rules around participation to safeguard the fairness of sport. And the new rules came into effect at the end of 2023, divided cyclists into female and open categories. The female category remains for those with sex assigned female at birth and transgender men who are not yet to begin hormone therapy. The open category is for male athletes, transgender women and men, non-binary individuals and those whose sex was assigned male at birth. Sebastian Coe, president of World Athletics, has voiced his views about the transgender debate. And last March, in his long-stated belief that biology trumped gender, banning athletes who had gone through male puberty from the female category in World Championships and Olympic Games to preserve fairness in athletics. However, the problem does not exist within elite levels of sport. On that journey to elite sport, women will be at a constant disadvantage as they strive to win against males who are biologically stronger, taller and have increased muscle mass. These men will take podium places from them and their space in teams, excluding many women and girls from taking part at all. You cannot escape the biological reality. It is vital that we stand up for single-sex categories in sport across all levels, from grassroots to elite. This should be protected. You cannot settle for protecting 0.01% at the top if you then ask every other woman and girl to accept being placed at an advantage. That's why I'm backing Tess White's motion, and I will always champion single-sex categories in sport.
Thank you. Ms Webber, I now call on Rona Mackay to be followed by Carol Mochan. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be speaking in this debate to celebrate Scottish Women and Girls in Sport Week. And I want to focus my contribution on the huge leap forward in all areas of sport that today's women and girls in Scotland have made. I pay tribute to them for leading the way by being great role models and encouraging more women and girls to get active. And I want to applaud them for their incredible successes, which show that, as always, Scotland punches above its weight in competitive sport. As a great example, Celtic Women Football Club have just become the first Scottish team to qualify for the Women's Champions League group stage. Congratulations to them. And of course, Scotland's women's team have done us proud on the international stage time after time. Presiding Officer, these firsts are so important when you think that women were banned from playing football in Scotland until the 70s. It's absolutely incredible to think of that. This senseless ban led the legendary Rose Riley to leave Scotland and to go to Italy, where she won the World Cup in 1984. Pretty impressive. She was voted best player for AC Milan and went on to win a multitude of footballing awards. Incidentally, Rose was only allowed to play for Celtic Boys Club, who had scouted her, if she cut her hair short and called herself Ross. That's absolutely staggering. We certainly have come a long way, although I do believe progress is needed in the gender pay gap for players. Women's football has a huge fan base and generates ever-increasing crowds at matches. Presiding Officer, I want to tell the Chamber today of a remarkable wee girl who lives in the East End of Glasgow. Her name is Mirren Kennedy and she's just 9 years old. Mirren was scouted by Hearts just before summer after they'd seen her play in our regional team Finnart Girls, and she now plays in the Hearts Development Squad, which is the first step on the next generation pathway. Young Mirren is certainly in demand. Celtic are interested in her and she's also currently training with Kilmarnock. Now, all that's remarkable in itself, but even more so when I tell you that Mirren suffers from cystic fibrosis. Thankfully, she's made great progress on the calf trio medication and her lung function is presently normal. Nothing can stop this wee inspiration. In my view, she's the embodiment of the she can, she will hashtag. She's a star already at the tender age of 9. Mum Ashley, Dad Robert and the wider family are beyond proud of her, as I'm sure the whole of Scotland is. Her determination not to be held back against all odds by her condition must be an inspiration to girls from all backgrounds. Taking part in sport has so many benefits for women and girls, both on their mental and physical health. I wasn't particularly sporty at school, but I did love netball. I still remember the excitement of playing against other schools and the thrill of winning a match. I understand Sport Scotland has introduced walking netball, which may be more suited to my capabilities these days. The SNP Scottish Government is working to increase women and girls' participation in sport, progressing the commitment to double investment in sport and active living to £100 million by the end of this Parliament. Across all 32 local authorities in the last year, over 129,000 girls and young women made over 2.1 million visits to active school session, with netball, football and multi-sports sessions proving most popular. Fit for Girls is a national programme developed in partnership by Sports Scotland and the Youth Sport Trust, and the Young Ambassadors Initiative is a key element of Sports Scotland's contribution to developing young people as leaders in sport. Each year, two pupils from each secondary school in Scotland are chosen as young ambassadors to promote sport and motivate and inspire other young people to get involved in sport in their schools, clubs and local communities. And teenage girls consistently make up more than half of all young ambassadors, and that's hugely encouraging. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, women and girls in Scotland are leading the way in a whole range of sports, from football and rugby to netball and boxing and so much more. They are punching above their weight, and long may that continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call on Carol Mochan to be followed by Karen Adam. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thank you to Tess White for bringing this important issue to the Chamber. And can I welcome, like others, Women and Girls in Sports Week. I understand this subject for many people feels that the feeling is very strong. And I think this is why it requires the attention of Parliament and should come to the Chamber floor. I want to try my contribution as much as I can, show that I believe in a sports provision that is fair, safe and allows everyone to have an opportunity to compete and enjoy a whole variety of sports. I also want to describe my constituents' views as far as I can. Now, I am contacted regularly by constituents and also people outside of South of Scotland about this issue. And that is on both sides of this debate. But primarily, the feedback I receive is that a great number of women feel their voices are not being heard when it comes to sport and inclusion of women in sport. And I think we can all agree that this is not acceptable. We have to hear those voices. And it's our responsibility in this chamber to do that. I do not profess to have all the answers, but what I can say with certainty is that there is a clear, or there clearly is a need for more research and increased time allowed for individual sports to decide on how we discuss this and make decisions about how we progress this matter. We cannot rush into altering the very fundamentals of competition without doing due diligence. Millions of people take sporting competition very seriously, either actively or as a spectator, and we would be remiss as a parliament if we simply dismissed the concerns from women about the engagement of transgender in sport. We have to take time to listen and we have to learn. Presiding Officer, we will all surely agree that sport must be safe and as fair as possible. And that's what we teach children from a very young age. And it's the spirit in, for example, the Commonwealth Games, which will be coming back to Scotland in a couple of years. So I do believe that we require transparency and a logical approach to fairness and harm avoidance. As others have mentioned, we do have the Equality Act, and it does have an exemption for us to act in terms of sport. And we do have sports leaders who have made comments. Others have made reference to them in cycling. The director had indicated that this could be the single biggest issue for Olympic sport. And of course, we have heard that in athletics, Seb Coe has said, you know, that this is making sport, women's sport, very fragile. So it's very important that we make progress with this. But if I can go back to the constituents I was speaking about, when I speak to constituents, they overall accept that there are some cases where someone who has transitioned could be able to compete alongside others of their gender, but we should be clear about that and be clear about what that looks like. When it comes to sports that feature high impact or frequent contact, there are legitimate concerns about the long-term health effects and this blanket approach. And in sports, as we've heard, someone who has experienced puberty as a male has significant natural advantage, and so much more consideration has to be given. Let's not forget it took many decades to get the public to even take women's athletics and women's sports seriously. And I think we owe a debt to women who built those foundations to be serious when making decisions about what we're doing. So I, as I said at the start, don't pretend to have the answers, but as parliamentarians, we have to listen, be open-minded with the experts where concerns are raised, and we cannot have a knee-jerk reaction. It is not good enough to make political points. And I think and I hope that by speaking up today, some of the people out there will understand that parliamentarians are listening and that we can take action on this point. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Ms. Morgan. And I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A little over 3 years ago, the official motto of the Olympic Games was changed, and the change added a single word to the original motto: faster, higher, stronger. And that single word, Presiding Officer, was together. The word together reflects the unifying power of sport and the importance of solidarity. And I do hope to echo that Olympic principle in my remarks today, particularly as we mark Scottish Women and Girls in Sport Week with the campaign slogan, Let's Move Together. Presiding Officer, only 100 years ago, after the women's suffrage movement of the 1920s, progress was made in women's participation in sport. And we were finally included in track and field events at the 1928 Olympics in Amsterdam. And this was despite severe opposition and extreme sexism. The women participating faced misogynistic fear-mongering, stating that they would become sterile, weak, or too masculine. Lena Radke of Germany set a world record at the 1928 Games for running 800 metres, but the media falsely reported that most of the female runners collapsed from exhaustion, even faking images to support the claims. And this led to a nationwide ban on women running races over 200 metres. And what was it they feared the most? That women weren't weak and masculine, but that women were in fact capable and that feminine can be exceptionally strong. The torrent of misogynistic abuse faced by female boxers, Iman Khalif, who represented Algeria, and Lin Yuting, who represented Taiwan, is horrendous. Here are two women, minoritised ethnic women, I might add, at the pinnacle of their sport. A sport that has a long and recent history of excluding women, with it only being as recently as 2012 that women were allowed to box for the first time at the Olympics competitively. When the referee raised Lynn and Cleese's hands in their respective 57kg and 66kg finals this summer, these two women, born female, raised female, possessing female passports, made history by winning their country's first gold medals in boxing. They deserved victories, however, were immediately tainted by those who challenged, without basis, their very womanhood. Where once women were denied participation in boxing because of their womanhood, now their womanhood was being denied because they overcame all odds to excel to the top of their sport. Too masculine, some decried. 100 years on, shameful. And it's on that note that I think this motion has fallen short, and I'm disappointed that Tess White's motion again raises concerns over the gender eligibility of athletes at the 2024 Paris Olympics, which I addressed with an amendment to a similar motion of hers just weeks ago. The International Olympic Committee President, Thomas Bach, said that the hate speech directed at boxers Iman Khalif and Lin Yuting at the Paris Olympics was totally unacceptable. And I agree with him. I also agree with him that we will not take part in politically motivated culture wars. The widespread disinformation and misinformation concerning the eligibility of the two women to compete in the Olympic Games was harmful not only to those women at the peak of their sport, but to the young women and girls who may see the abuse and decide against pursuing the passions or dreams. perhaps just because they do not fit what version of woman is deemed acceptable to some. Presiding officer, sport has the power to break barriers and challenge outdated norms, but only when we stand together in the face of adversity. We must continue to champion a future where all women, no matter their background or body type, are included. By confronting disinformation, standing against exclusion and fostering true inclusion, we will build a society where every woman and girl can pursue her dreams without fear. And it is only then, like the motto, we will all move faster, higher, stronger together. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Adam. And I now call Liz Smith, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. And can I bring us back to what I think is the spirit of sport? And I do so as the convener of the cross-party group on sport. And I'm very grateful to Tess White for bringing forth this topic for further discussion, because there's no doubt at all that it is an important one, as is evidenced in the comments that Sharon Davis has exemplified, and how much I personally agree with Sharon Davis. But it's also an issue which has been greatly exercising the minds of all the governing bodies represented by the Scottish Sports Association, who, of course, act as the secretariat to the cross-party group. And what a wonderful job they do, whether that is supporting our sporting bodies, but particularly when it comes to the difficult and sensitive matters, supporting all the volunteers across Scotland and encouraging much more accessible sport, even in difficult circumstances. Of course, Tess White's debate coincides with this year's Women and Girls in Sport Week. In the past, we have celebrated our national and international female champions, the volunteers who work with women and girls at the grassroots level, and all those who work so hard to make our sporting facilities more accessible to women and girls. This year, the theme is leadership. Now, that obviously can mean lots of different things. Leadership can mean that you're captain of a team. It can mean that you are part of a successful team inspiring others, or it's taking up sport for the very first time. But for me, it's also about courage and determination to overcome some of the barriers that are in place for women and girls. And that's why this motion is so important, because there are clearly several very serious barriers in the way for many women and girls, not least of which is their own personal safety. And I hope I can speak to the Chamber with very considerable many years of experience, maybe too many to recall, coaching several different sports where, for eminently sensible and practical reasons of personal safety, decisions had to be made about whether mixed teams were the better options or whether teams should be organised on a female or a male basis. And I note that these sensible and practical reasons about personal safety are exactly the same ones that are being used by sporting bodies when addressing the current controversies. And as the cross-party group convener, I support that. Tess White's motion and her speech rightly identify the extent of the current controversies, because it's not just a question of safety, but one of fairness, and I agree with that. She is quite right to highlight the concerns from the recent Olympics regarding gender eligibility, most especially in the very high-profile cases of boxing and athletics, and I think perhaps some of us would take a very different perspective on that. And she's also right to highlight the reactions from some of the world governing bodies which have decided to take action to prevent transgender participation in female sport, pending further research, and the reaction of the UN Special Rapporteur, to say nothing of the reaction from female and indeed male athletes themselves. But I want to finish on the motion's last point, namely the need for an open and transparent debate where no one feels that they are unable to speak up. Because in my very long experience in sport, that can never succeed if controversy gets in the way of what sport is supposed to be all about.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. And before I call the next speaker, I would advise members that due to the number of members who wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. And I now invite Tess White to move a motion without notice.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name.
To the extent. Thank you.
I move the motion.
The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Brian Whittle. Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I send a message to all the people of the world to uphold the Olympic principles and the Olympic Charter, to refrain from bullying all athletes because it has effects, massive effects. It can destroy people. It can kill people's thoughts, spirit and mind. These are the powerful words of Olympic champion Iman Khelif, who faced unprecedented levels of abuse, vitriol, harassment, just for being excellent at what she does. I cannot celebrate the motion we have before us, nor the debate this evening. Both this and Tess White's previous motion on the same subject echo the most toxic narratives, with elements of them unfounded in fact, discriminatory in effect, and deeply damaging to both trans and cisgender women and girls in sport and in our communities. I strongly commend the briefing from Leap Sport Scotland for its excellent analysis of the true position. And I thank Karen Adam for her spirited and principled amendment to that first motion. That amendment rightly calls out the torrent of misogynistic abuse faced by the two Olympic boxers, cis women, incidentally, and both women of colour. It identifies the political motivations of the attacks upon them and calls upon parliamentarians and others to counter the disinformation that threatens the safety of female athletes, threatens the safety, I would add, of women everywhere. That's why I'm here this afternoon. There are people watching this debate and people who will hear it reported who are understandably afraid. Transgender people, non-binary people, intersex people, women who do not conform to conventional, Eurocentric or white assumptions of body shape, demeanour or dress. People who fear that they will be next to face exclusion, rejection, excoriation and hate. To those people, our friends and neighbours, I say as I have before, I, like Karen Adams, stand here with you and for you in solidarity and commitment for as long as it takes for this poison to be washed from our politics, our media and our life. If Tess White had ended her motion with the first clause, I think we could all have agreed very clearly, because there are serious and multiple barriers to women and girls' safe and fair participation in sport, as has been highlighted by the briefing from Sport Scotland. There are governments, federations and broadcasting authorities that deliberately ban, suppress, downgrade or obscure women's sport. There are coaches and managers who bully and abuse, including widespread sexual abuse. There are men who rape children and go on to represent their countries at the highest level. Tess White's motion makes no mention of the Olympic beach volleyball player who did just that. Why no fuss made of a convicted rapist participating at the Olympics? I wonder. There are playing fields sold off by state schools. There are swimming pools emptied and unused for want of essential repair. There is, as we've debated here before, a huge chasm, especially for women and girls, where safe, accessible public transport and provision for active travel ought to be. All these obstacles are substantial and significant, and I hope we do get the opportunity to debate all of these. But the participation of transgender women in sport, as in culture and the arts, in voluntary work, in public life or business, is no barrier to others. And it is deeply sad that narratives such as those contained in this motion are used to spread anxiety and hostility, to build barriers where none are needed, and to cause the deepest pain to those already bearing heavy burdens. Sport, from a toddler's first wobbly kick of the family football to an Olympic podium, can be for millions of women and girls a source of health, well-being, friendship, self-esteem, and sheer joy. We can all share that, no matter our body type, our culture, the colour of our skin, or the precise details of our biological makeup. In this chamber and beyond, we can be proud to celebrate diversity, to recognise the labour of achievement, and to stand resolute with all who need our solidarity. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Brian Whistle to be followed by Ash Regan. Mr Whistle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by thanking my colleague, Tess White, for bringing this debate to the Chamber? And I think, given consistent attempts to prevent discussion or air concerns on the issue, I think it takes real bravery and commitment to fairness in women's sport to keep this discussion current. I wanted to listen to the debate today before framing what I wanted to say. I think everybody knows that I've been involved in sport at all levels for 50 years or so, and I do genuinely believe, strongly believe, that every person should have access to sport and physical activity. Presiding officer, on the one hand, we're talking about one of the most vulnerable groups of people in our communities who have endured much violence and prejudice, as Maggie Chapman has said, and on the other, we're discussing fairness and safety in women's sport, especially those sports where strength and speed are prevalent. The issues we're discussing today were predicted in the gender recognition debate way back when the bill was progressing through Parliament. What we're seeing in sport was an inevitable outcome of not dealing with it back then. I spoke then about the huge differentiation going through puberty as a man compared to a woman brings. Muscle mass of over 30% difference, bone density of over 30%, heart and lung size, as well as the all-important Q angle at the hip. Differences that no matter how dedicated a female sportswoman is, no matter how hard they train, they cannot come near to compensating for those biological facts. It was bad enough to watch a 51-year-old trans woman in the 200, 400 metres at the Paralympics taking the place of what should have been a biological woman. A trans woman who, incidentally, had won 11 national titles as a man. But the grotesque sight of women being bludgeoned by two XY chromosome boxers just brought the reality of what we're discussing here and the discussion we had in the GRR bill. An equivalent size man can generate 160% of the force a woman can generate. And I remember back in the GRR bill, all I was asking for was advice to be given to sport, and that was denied. And I wonder what our future sportswomen are making of that just now. Because it's not just an international sport, it is prevalent in grassroots sports all the way through, and I've seen it many, many times in Scotland. Now, I had a trans woman come to my surgery to discuss this particular issue. And she said to me that she had been banned from taking part in cycling. And I said to her, you haven't been banned at all, you've been banned from taking part in women's cycling. And I explained to her the reasons why. And her suggestion to me is, why can't I compete in a different category? Why can't? So the trans community themselves understand the issues here. You see, presiding officer, making the wrong decisions, however well-intentioned, are still the wrong decisions. You cannot create equality for one group by creating inequality for another. It is hugely important that sport is inclusive and accessible to all, irrespective of background or personal circumstances. But it's also crucial that safety and fairness are considered when we set these rules. The topic of this debate was inevitable, given that no matter how much we strive for that equality, there are certain circumstances where biology matters, where XX and XY chromosomes matter. Women's sport is governed by biology and cannot be defined in any other way. We need to have a balanced discussion, presiding officer, and we need better solutions to ensure that fairness, inclusion and, most of all, safety for women's sport. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call Ash Regan to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Ms Regan.
Thank you, presiding officer. And I'll start my contribution by commending Tess White on securing this debate and for her excellent contribution this evening. But as we celebrate Scottish women and girls in sport week, we must also confront, as many speakers this evening have done, the critical issues that are currently affecting the future of women's sport and indeed the safety and the rights of women and girls across all areas of life. While inclusion is a core value of our society, we must ensure this doesn't come at the expense of fairness, of safety, and the integrity of women and girls, including in sports. And one of the most pressing concerns today is the impact of policies that allow biological males to compete in the female category. And this issue was, of course, brought to the forefront during the recent Paris Olympics, where the participation of male athletes raised severe concerns about the safety and fairness of competition in the female category. Now, physical differences between male and female athletes cannot be ignored, and studies have shown that male athletes have, on average, a significant advantage. And this creates a fundamentally unequal playing field in women's sports, where biological males can potentially outcompete female athletes. And the safety of women and girls is crucial. So in contact sports such as boxing, rugby and mixed martial arts, the inclusion of biological males poses significant physical risks to female athletes. The UN 2024 report has been extensively quoted, but I don't think it is a bad thing to repeat the statistic that males have, on average, 162% greater punching power than females. And if anyone watching this debate, if they only take away that one statistic, I don't think that would be a bad thing. Allowing male-born athletes to compete in female categories in these type of sports puts women and girls not only at a significant disadvantage in terms of competition, but it also risks their personal safety. So it's crucial, I think, to repeat, as I've done many times in the Chamber in the last few months, that gender self-ID is not the law in Scotland, and Scottish law has not changed, despite pressure from, I believe, the government and others to adopt self-ID in various areas, including sport. These protections must be rigorously defended if the integrity and fairness of competition in sport is to be upheld, and the right of women and girls to compete in a fair and a safe environment should be protected by policies that do not allow male-born athletes to self-identify into female categories due to the physical advantages that they retain. The ongoing debate within sports governing bodies such as World Athletics, FINA and World Rugby reflects this growing recognition and acknowledgement of the impact that these policies are having on women's sports. Some sports governing bodies have already moved to prevent transgender women from competing in female categories in the acknowledgement of the risks to fairness and to safety. But we have an opportunity here now, Presiding Officer. We are now looking ahead to 2026 and the Glasgow Commonwealth Games. And we have, I think, a unique opportunity here to inspire women and girls to participate in sports. The world will be watching us, and we must ensure that these opportunities remain fair and safe for our female athletes. And leaders in this area, like Judy Murray, have worked tirelessly to promote girls' participation in sports. And we can build on that legacy by protecting single-sex categories at all levels of competition. I'll be interested to hear what the government is doing to ensure that for 2026. The consequences of not addressing the risks to female sports go beyond immediate physical safety of women and girls. If their safety, their dignity and their aspirations cannot be assured, women and girls' very inclusion in sport is at risk.
Thank you, Ms Regan. And I call Sharon Dowie. Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank my colleague Tess White for bringing this vitally important debate into the Chamber. Recently, we have seen increasing concern over gender eligibility in elite competitions. This is not an easy debate to have, but it's one that we must have with respect and openness to all. Many are afraid to speak out because of fears they would be seen as discriminatory. But this is nothing to do with discrimination. It is everything to do with fairness in sport, ensuring that female athletes are not disadvantaged by physical differences. Studies show that male puberty provides significant advantages in areas like speed, strength and endurance. This cannot be ignored if we are to preserve the integrity and fairness of women's sport. It is crucial that we approach this matter with understanding for all individuals involved. Transgender athletes deserve respect, but we must find better solutions that do not compromise fairness and safety for female athletes. It would be unfair to female athletes to not have this debate. This is not about exclusion, but about maintaining a fair playing field.
Yep.
As policymakers, we must ensure an open and respectful debate, one based in facts, backed up by science, focused in fairness and with a pinch of common sense. Yeah, yeah. Sportswomen should not be made uncomfortable in their own sports. Many have expressed fears over sharing their opinion publicly because of concerns they would be seen as discriminatory. Yeah. This does not seem like an open discussion to me if female athletes are afraid to voice their concerns about justice. And we must be able to have a debate in the Chamber where we're not afraid to take interventions on the subject because it seems controversial. Making sure every athlete gets the opportunity to participate in a fair, secure and safe environment is key to preserving women's sports in the future. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. And I now call on Minister Marie Todd to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As everyone will know, it's not just because I'm the Minister for Sport that I take an interest in sport and women and girls' participation. As a person, I've always passionately believed that sport and physical activity is for everyone and is very beneficial to both our physical and our mental health. Women and Girls in Sport Week's an annual campaign in which we showcase the benefits of sport and physical activity for women and girls across Scotland. This week is the highlight of my sporting calendar, an opportunity to recognise and to celebrate the amazing women and girls across Scotland, both those that take part in sport and physical activity and those that provide opportunities for others to participate. Sport should, as many have said, provide an inclusive space where everyone can be themselves and where there are opportunities for everyone to take part and where we treat each other with kindness, dignity and respect. It's often been said in this chamber that when it comes to transgender issues, society could be much kinder, more dignified and respectful. And as elected representatives, we should lead the way in that discourse. As is known, sports governing bodies set their own rules on transgender participation, in line with guidance provided by the five UK sports councils. The aim of this guidance is to support sports to better understand the needs and challenges involved in ensuring that everyone can take part. And I'm sure we would all agree that sports organisations know their sports best. Deputy Presiding Officer, gender equality is at the heart of the Scottish Government's vision for a fairer Scotland. So we all want to see opportunities for women and girls to be physically active in whatever way works best for them. This is important because we know that women and girls are less likely to participate in sport and are less likely to meet the recommended levels of physical activity with resulting implications for their physical and mental health. Certainly.
Tess White.
Thank you, Minister, for the intervention. Just 2 points. So the first point, do you believe that we should be able to discuss this openly and calmly and women and men without fear of recrimination or condemnation? That's my first question. And my second question is, do you agree with the president of the World Athletics, Sebastian Coe, that we must preserve the female category? Thank you.
Always through the chair, Minister.
So let me be absolutely clear. I think that every subject is up for clear and respectful debate in this chamber. I think it's really important that we are able to discuss difficult issues on which we may disagree respectfully. I think we need to be very, very, very careful about ensuring we do not perpetuate misinformation around these very sensitive themes, and I would plead everyone to take care with that. In terms of my view on Seb Coe's views, what I would do is quote that the UK Sports Council guidance is absolutely clear that transgender inclusion, fairness and safety can't be balanced in gender-affected sport. The International Olympic Committee is absolutely clear in their framework on fairness, inclusion and non-discrimination. They recognise that there can't be a one-size-fits-all. The Equality Act of 2010, could I just complete this point? The Equality Act of 2010 also includes an explicit exemption allowing organisations who deliver sport to exclude transgender participants from participating in the sex category with which they identify,
where physical strength, stamina or physique are major factors in determining success or failure, and which one sex is generally at a disadvantage in comparison with the other. It also makes it lawful to restrict participation of transsexual people in such competitions if this is necessary to uphold fair or safe competition, but not otherwise. Now, this year's theme is leadership, and it's vital that we have both female and male leaders and mentors in sport driving change for women and girls, whether they're friends or family members, community leaders or coaches in the boardroom of sports bodies. And I'm absolutely sure that many here today will know of those people. We want individuals and organisations to consider how they are ensuring their communities are represented at all levels, and that they help to drive an inclusive and collaborative culture and address the intersectionality of additional barriers to participation. This year, we've been able, all of us, to admire the performance of Scottish women on the world's biggest sports stages. We should acknowledge how impactful they are as role models for women and girls, helping to challenge norms, dismantle harmful misconceptions, and replace them with images of female empowerment. So I warmly congratulate our Olympic and Paralympic athletes who have done just that at Paris this year. From Sammy Kinghorn setting a new Paralympic record in the T5300 metres to Eilish McColgan, who became the first Scottish four-time track and field Olympian. Scottish athletes have done us proud, and their leadership will be an inspiration for the next generation. We know that you cannot be what you cannot see, and increasing the visibility of women in sport can create a ripple effect and empowers others to participate. I know there's fantastic work going on across the sports sector to provide opportunities for women and girls, and I want to take this opportunity to thank all of the hardworking individuals who go above and beyond. Now, just yesterday, I had the privilege of meeting with Street Soccer Scotland. I got to see their Street 45 programme for Women in Action. I meet with incredible female leaders and participants and hear about the many benefits that the programme provides. I heard really powerful stories of recovery, of learning new skills, fulfilling untapped potential, of acceptance of themselves for some of those women for the first time in their lives. They spoke about the warm welcome, the support, that they didn't face judgment. Again, for some of those women, the very first time in their lives. That is the power of sport, and who wouldn't want that for everyone? On Monday, the First Minister launched the week at the University of the Highlands and Islands, Perth College, and announced Sport Scotland's new investment of £1.45 million into the Active Campuses Network. That extends the investment into the programme, which started in 2023, by a further 2 years. So now it will run until 2027. It will further serve colleges' diverse student community by creating a more representative and inclusive sporting system and supporting more women to participate. I am very much looking forward to further engagements this week, and I know that my ministerial colleagues feel the same. I was delighted to learn that there's going to be 10 ministerial engagements over the course of Women and Girls in Sport Week across a whole range of portfolios. And I believe this is a testament to our commitment to women and girls in sport. I want to encourage all other members of Parliament, partners and individuals across Scotland to consider how they can get involved, not just this week, but every week, in encouraging more women and girls to be active and to support the week on social media by using the hashtag #SheCanSheWill. I look forward to seeing your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and there'll be a short pause before we move on to the final item of business. Thank you.